Hello, and welcome. It's time again. It's time for the review of Unital Ring. Oh man, I've been waiting for this book for a while, especially off the cliffhanger of the last one. So we are here to discuss. I think I went much quicker reading this book than the last one. I think my one chapter per day thing worked very well for me. So let's not waste any time. You're here for. Let's get to what you're here for. I'm talking about Unital Ring. So we start off from where we left off. Perfect. We fight the Life Harvester, which is just, you know, the Skull Reaper with skin and all that stuff. So Kirito comes up with the idea that, you know, he and Asuna, hopefully they remember the attack pattern of the Skull Reaper, and since the Life Harvester is the Skull Reaper, they can beat it. So he and Asuna, they run up to the Skull Reaper, Life Harvester, whatever you want to call it. And, we get a nice battle scene of one group attacking on the right, one group attacking on the left, and then Kirito and Asuna running up to attack it. So pretty much the same formation they did when they fought the boss on floor 75. And it works! And they get some help, actually, because it looked like that they were gonna fail, but they get some help from the Bastion and Patter, who show up at the end, and they help him defeat the boss, which is a nice little moment. So, after defeating the Life Harvester, we start talking, they eat all the meat it dropped, so that solves their food problem right now, because they've got so much meat from the Life Harvester, their food problem is solved. So they start having a conversation with the Insecticide people. So we have Aegil's wife. She says that, you know, she and her group, they'll help Kirito with Mutasena and all that stuff, which is nice. They also say that, you know, their flying has been kind of, I think they say their flying is gone right now at the moment because, you know, they're all bugs. So some of them have wings, but they can't actually use them right now. Well, that sucks, but you know. Then we have Argo talking about the Unital Ring map. And apparently the map is about 850 miles altogether. That is a big freaking map. That is huge. So then the Insecticide people lock out because obviously time difference, so it's very late for them. And then Kirito and everyone begin planning how we're going to deal with Mutasena's big attack with her army. Okay, this is when Kirito tells them about the curse of the noose thing. And they're like, oh, well, we can just ignore it because it's fake. So it doesn't actually hurt us. Kirito tells them, well, actually, you can't do that. And then shows, I have, you know, the noose thing. So they all decide after that, log out, take a little bit of a bathroom break. There Kirito is scolded by both Yui and Tsuguha for lying, you know, like he always is, because Kirito's always lying. In my notes here, Yui's name was changed to Yuri for some reason, so we're gonna fix that. Thanks, autocorrect. It's great, it doesn't actually want to change it. There we go. Yui. There we go. Okay, so we log back in. And Kirito's like, okay, we should probably try and avoid a direct confrontation with this group, because even though we now have the Insecticide people, and the Patter and Bastion are gonna join them, still Mutasena's army does outmatch them numbers wise, but again, Kirito's hoping maybe them just seeing the Insecticide people will screw them up long enough for us to attack. And then Kirito comes up with a plan. We don't find out what the plan is right away, of course, but we'll find out later. They got a plan. So that Kirito and Argo, they start scouting. And then eventually they're like, okay, yeah, this is the perfect place for the plan. Which again, they are very ambiguous on what the plan is. So then, Asuna runs into the transfer student from a previous volume. Oh my god. Shikimi Kamura. Now, I am of the belief that Kamura, it's very early, is Mutasina. I don't think it's a stretch for me to believe she's Mutasina. I think there's actual evidence that proves, yeah, she could be Mutasina. So, and there's evidence in the book that kind of shows, hey, maybe she is Mutasina. So, you know, that's my big hot take, that I believe that she is Mutasina. Apparently, also, I found this out that Kamura is the name of the company that makes the game in Excel World. Is that true? Or is it... No, that's not true. It's that Kamura is the last name of one of the characters in Excel World. And that, apparently, Kamura's company runs Ordinal Scale. And the Agma and all that stuff. So, I tell me if that's true. I don't know. I don't watch Excel World. So tell me if that's true. But anyway, Shikimi asks Asuna, hey, can we have lunch today? You know, talk? And Asuna's like, I can't. Because they were planning to, during their lunch break, talk more about the raid going on. And Asuna's like, we can have lunch tomorrow. And he's like, sure. So they're going to have lunch. Awesome. Asuna also noticed that Shikimi's pin on her jacket is to the school Asuna went to before, of course, SAO. And Asuna starts to wonder how different her life would have been if she never went to SAO. Okay, then we log back into Unirig later on that night, and the Insecticide players have captured a salamander who is part of Mutasina's army. Leafa recognizes him, and he is the same salamander who gave her and Kirito info from the Lugru Corridor all the way back in Fairy Dance. He was brought back for this. His name is Frisco. We give him a name this time. And Kirito again just intimidates him. It's just like, just tell me the info. The guy's like, okay, I will. So he tells them how the army's planning to attack, what are their strengths and weaknesses, all that type of stuff. So the gang then head into the forest where Mutasina's army is there, and haha, they're heading for our trap. And then we activate the trap, the plan, which is Kirito made a dam on where there's water. He made a dam, and then the plan is they're gonna break that dam, so then a bunch of water rushes and, you know, hopefully flushes away some of Mutasina's army, and then they can attack her, kill her right away, and then don't have to deal with the noose. So, they do that. Like they said, the army is kind of swept away by the water, so that's good. Kirito goes to attack Mutasina, but his sword is stopped by Magus, who is one of Mutasina's top people. And Frisco said that Mutasina has three top people, which is Magus, who is, I believe, he's like a mage, and then Viola and Dia, who are twin swordswomen. They're like the three main, like, Mutasina's, like, head cheese. So, Kirito, he gets his sword shield stopped by Magus. However, he does see that the person he attacked wasn't actually Mutasina. It's a body double. Oh my god. So, Kirito, he, like, starts looking around. You know, where is she? He looks up. There's a giant bird circling around. And he's like, there she is. Bingo. She's on the bird. And then, suddenly, because the plan has now kind of gone awry, everyone is hit with the noose. So everyone now has the noose curse. And he's like, well, damn, how do we cut her down? Thankfully, Misha the bear that they tamed can throw spikes. So Misha throws spikes at the bear, and then Shinon finishes... Misha throws spikes at the bird, and then Shinon uses her musket and shoots down the bird. So Kirito and Asuna both run over where Mutasina should be, and they're like, we gotta kill her now. However, just as they're about to do it, they are stopped by, of course, the twins Viola and Dia. And then Mutasina activates the noose. And they're all, you know, holding their necks like, ah, damn it. And Mutasina says, I'll let this go if you swear to me. So they gotta, you know, be like everyone else in her army. Swear to her. However, and I did not expect this, Yui rushes in and just starts going to town attacking Mutasina. I was like, whoa, Yui. This is her moment. So Kirito, he sees what Yui's doing. So he uses decay magic and he launches it into his mouth. And the feeling of disgust of, like, you know, launching this brown, ewy, gooey stuff in your mouth. For a while, it negates the feeling of suffocation, so he uses that brief moment to attack Mutasina, and he breaks her staff. He ends the curse. We get the fantastic illustration, which that's a villain shot, buddy. That's a villain shot. And he goes right to kill her, but Magis shows up, uses a smokescreen, and that allows him, Mutasina, the twins, and Mutasina's body double to escape. So, they are all gone. But thankfully, they won the battle. They didn't win the war. The war is not over. But we won the battle. And thankfully, Mutasina's army is more than happy to just say, yeah, screw Mutasina, we're on your side now. And the army kind of moves into Ruis Nanrig. Kirito actually tames the bird that Mutasina flew on and names it Namari. So, that's nice. And then we get on the underworld portion. That's the Uninoring portion of this volume done. Overall, I liked it. Sometimes, I will admit, I do find the Uninoring stuff quite boring. And there is the tendency to pad some of the stuff in Uninoring with, like, over-explaining stuff. But overall, I felt that this one was a lot more interesting than the other ones. I feel. Especially more interesting than last volume's Uninoring. This one was definitely more interesting. But it's mainly because, you know, we had the Life Harvester fight and then the battle of Mutasina. So two big events, you know? So now we move on to the underworld part. Where, okay, Kirito dives into the underworld and he ends up exactly where he logged out last time. Which means in the middle of the damn road. Thankfully, there's an entire roadblock just around where he is. And he gets into one of the cars. And he is taken into a villa in the woods where Eolene lives. Now, Eolene now kind of believes Kirito's the Star King now, like, because before he was kind of indifferent, now he kind of is more believing of it. He tells Kirito about his family, Herlintz, who are descendants of Bercoli. That's awesome. Bercoli's last name was Herlintz. That's sweet. And they say, like, you know, the family restarted because of the son Bercoli had with Fanatio. He took the name again. Which I'm like, oh, that's such cool. That's so cool. So Kirito's like, ah, so you're related to Bercoli. And Eolene goes, no, I am adopted. So more stuff, you know, who's Eolene's real parents? Mm-hmm. Eolene basically asks Kirito, why have you logged back in? You know, why are you back after all this time? And Kirito says, well, someone has from our world has logged into the underworld and we want to know who, and I also want to unite my friend with someone. Which, of course, he wants to unite Alice with Selka. So Eolene goes, I can help you with those. I'll help you find out who this mysterious person is and I'll help your friend reunite. But you gotta do something for me. You have to come with me to the planet Admina. And Kirito's like, ooh. Okay. At this point, Asuna and Alice arrive. Kirito then asks Eolene, why do you want to go to Admina? And Eolene explains that the abyssal whore that the trio saw when they logged into the underworld at the end of War of Underworld was not supposed to be there. They said, Stisa and Laurentier were not meant to be attacked. They were just meant to, like, you know, go out, kind of scout, is it there? Because of info they got from Admina. and it's like, oh, they might have sabotaged, you know, fall. So he only wants to see if they've actually sent them false information to get Stisa and Lord Hanye killed, or if it was a mistake. And, you know, we can understand why. So Kirito's like, how are we going to get there? Because, you know, we take a ship, people are going to know. We can't just fly there. So Eileen goes, it's fine. We're going to take the Star King's personal dragon craft, which was named after the Floor 55 boss in Ironcrag. And, you know, Kirito and Asta share a look at each other, because for some reason they don't want to just admit you're the damn Star King and the Queen. I don't know why he wants to fight this. I wouldn't be fighting it if I was in this situation. It'd be cool, I'm the king. Sweet. So, Eileen calls for a car. People drive in the car. It's Lorania and Stise. And, you know, Eileen's like, I told them not to. But they wanted to come. So, Asuna and Alice change out of their armor into Integrity pilot uniforms. And Kirito doesn't have to change because Eileen's like, that's just citizen wear. You're fine, bro. So then we're in the car. We're driving. Kirito asks Eileen if he can see his Stasia window because he wants to see if Eileen's, you know, character ID is the same as Yugio's. And Eileen's like, okay, I'll do it, but you guys show me yours. Fair trade here. And Kirito's like, yeah, I got nothing to hide, you know? So Eileen, he does it. He opens the Stasia window. And, actually, Kirito opens his first. And we see that his, you know, object control authority and system control authority, his object control is 29 and his system control is 7. And he goes, I've gone down? And Eileen kind of looks at it. And Kirito's like, oh, well, this is proof. I'm not the Star King. Look how low my stuff is. However, Eileen then notices, have you noticed that's kind of like a 1 there? So Kirito has triple digits. So his system control is not 29, it's 129. I mean, his object control is 129. His system control is not 7, it's 107. So he is way above what normally the numbers are. Eileen's like, I've never seen numbers like that before. Which, you know, it makes sense that Kirito's system and object control is so high. I'm assuming Asuna is exactly the same. So Eileen opens up his Stasia window. Kirito's like, you know, oh. However, his ID is not the same as Yugio's. Eileen and Yugio, different IDs. So we arrive at Central Cathedral. We head into an elevator or a levitator, whatever. And we are about to go to the 80th floor. Because that's where the garden is, where Selka is hiding, or deep freeze. So Kirito goes to press a button, however, he notices, hey, there's a hidden button in this elevator. So he uses incarnation very, very lightly to press the button, and they go straight up to the 80th floor. So they try to open the door, but it won't budge, nothing. However, they then see there's 4 slots over there, sword slots. So Alice takes her Osmonte's blade, slaps it in, twist. Asuna takes Radiant Light, puts it in, twist. Kirito takes the Night Sky Blade, Blue Rose Sword, puts it in, twist. The door opens. And who is there? But Selka! She's there in deep freeze under the Osmanthus tree. But she's not alone, because it looks like standing guard is Ronnie and Tisei. Tisei and Ronnie, they are there. And that is where we end this volume. So that's it. That's Unital Ring 20. That's Sword Online Volume 25, Unital Ring 4. Overall, which I don't wear. I don't wear overalls. But overall, I loved this one. This was a great one. This one was really strong. This was as strong as Volume 1. Volume 1 was very strong. I think because, you know, that's the whole introduction to everything. Volume 2 was okay. That one was okay, I think. You know, not as strong as number 1, but it was good. Volume 3, I think, was the weakest so far, especially the Unital Ring parts. The Underworld stuff was very interesting, but the Unital Ring aspect was not. However, this one, both the Unit Ring and Underworld stuff was very interesting. Obviously, we're more interested in Underworld than Unit Ring, but anyway, it's still fun. I still really enjoyed this one. Let's get translated in Volume 26, guys. Volume 27 comes out in Japan this month. Let's get Volume 26 out soon here in North America. Get that English. So overall, I'm going to give the book 8.5, I think. A strong 8.5. Like, I loved it, but it's not the best, is it? It's not the best book I've ever read, you know? And that's it. That's it for the Unit Ring review. Let me know what you guys thought of the book if you read it in the comments down below. And I'll see you all next time.